Data is very important when it comes to programming, storing of data. With this, a very good morning to all. Today, we are going to learn a very important topic of data structures, that is in Python. So today, we are just going to do a briefing of it. So let's just start. What we are going to learn today is what are data structures, then why these data structures are needed, and the type of data structures in Python. We have two types, built-in and user-defined data structures. In which built-in we have list, dictionaries, tuple, and set. And in user-defined we have arrays, stacks, queue, linked list, trees, and many more. So one by one we are going to discuss these all topics today. So just first starting here with the question that what is a data structure? So basically it is a group of different type of data which is to be stored in a specific way so that we can process it as a single unit. मतलब it is a kind of data type which stores some values, different values or similar values so that we can access it in future anytime and very easily without any complexity. Generally, data structures are used to organize, store and manage data for efficient access and modifications. Whenever, in a programming, data is really important aspect. So we need to manage our data in a proper format so that we can access it anytime efficiently and without creating any problem. Or without any issue. So I think you are clear with this. What is a data structure? Then why a data structure is needed? So I am going to say, just imagine that you are having your study table, and in your study table, on your study table, you, one side you are having your pen holders where all the pens are there. On the second side, you have your books available. Third corner, you have your laptop or your charger or any other stuff which you need while studying, and then you have this study lamp also, or it is not having, that is not a big issue. So if it is placed systematically, if the first condition or the best condition is if your all the things, all the materials on your table is placed systematically, so your hand will directly go to that particular place and you will be able to access anything very fast, in a faster way. Now the second case is if everything is available in your on your study table but it is completely messed, all things are here and there, no thing, no material is there at its actual place. So what it happens, you will find hard to find out the places, to find out the materials. Right, and the third or the worst case is, let's say the material here, the books you want is not on your table. So what you will do, you will have to make a struggle and go and search for the book and then study. Right, so that is why we need to manage our space so that we can work efficiently. In the same way, when it comes to data, so data is also to be stored in a very good manner so that we can access and modify the data as per our requirements. Then moving ahead, what are the types of data structures? So we have two types of data structures in Python: list, built-in data structures, and user-defined data structures. Built-in means built-in are the data structures which are given by the Python only. They are default. We can use them like list, tuple, dictionary, and set. But in user-defined data structures, these are created by the user as per their requirement. Stack, queue, linked list, and linear array or tree are the example of some user-defined data structures. We have graph also in user-defined data structures. Moving ahead, let's just discuss it one by one. So first, we are going to study built-in data structures. Already we have studied before earlier many times what all these things are. So let's just have a review of this. List is a structure which contains heterogeneous data type. It means it contains mixed values, like you can store integer, floating number, or string, or complex number in a single list. That is why it is known as heterogeneous. Also, they are mutable. Mutable means once if we have created a list, so we can make changes, we can modify a list as per our requirement, we can delete the data, we can add the data, and many more operations can be taken care in the list. That is why these are known as mutable. Then we have tuple. Tuple is also same as list, but these are not mutable. Once if we have created tuple, so we cannot make any changes into it. Second thing, list always starts with square bracket, and this tuple is of small brackets. Then moving ahead, we have dictionaries. Dictionaries are like this, curly braces, and it holds a key value pair. It always contains key values, which are always in the form of keys and values, and are mutable. These are mutable basically. Then moving, we have set. Set is an unordered collection of unique elements and are mutable. Set contains always unique elements. It never make duplicate values. And yes, it is mutable. Out of all four here available here, only tuple is there which is not mutable. Otherwise, rest of the data structures are mutable. So this is it for the built-in data structure. Now just move ahead, and we have user-defined data structures in which we have stacks, queues, linked list, and arrays. So just let us going to study this one by one. First we have array. These are used to store data of one type. It is just like a list, but the only difference is we store the data here of one type only, not mixed value. Homogeneous data is to be stored. And they have index number, which is used to access the data, and the index number always starts from zero. So here, let's say this is my array, and here the index number is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and the size of my array is 5, because there are 5 columns. Okay? But the index, last index number will be 5 minus 1. The total size minus 1 will be the last index number. Then we have here stack. Now what a stack is? It is again made up of arrays. It uses the principle of LIFO. LIFO means last in, first out. It means last in, first out. What does it mean? It means whatever element is entered at the last, that particular element is going to be deleted first. They have a pointer called top, which is used to track the top of the element. So what actually happens here is, it is having one pointer which is known as top. Top is a pointer which always points the top of the element, the topmost element. Then insertion and deletion takes place from the top only. Yes, insertion and deletion, we can insert values or delete values from the top only. There is no other way. To add an element, we call that adding is known as pushing or push. And to delete an element, we called it as pop. Now let's have a look here. This is a book, and it is a stack of books basically, right? So let's say I want to remove this particular black book. If I am going to remove this book, so what will happen? The whole stack will let down. That is why we have to delete the book. If I want to delete this book, so I have to delete this first, then this, then this, then this, and so on. then only I can delete this book. Otherwise, first of all, these all books will be deleted, and then this book will be deleted. So the pointer is always at the top. This is the topmost element. If I want to delete it, so delete it, the first one, then the second one, then the third one, and so on. Again, if I want to add, then first element on the top, then next element, and then top will pointer to the last element. I think this is much clearer. And just have a look now. This is how a stack look like. Then moving ahead, we have queues here. You can see here is an example of a queue. In this queue, we have starting point and ending point, right? So let's just study what is it. It is again made up of arrays. It follows the principle of FIFO. First in, first out. But stacks follow the principle of LIFO, last in, first out. It means whatever element is going to be entered in the last, that particular element will be deleted first. But here in queue, the element which was entered first, that particular element is going to be deleted first. Just take an example of, let's say, this is a queue of paying electricity bill. Okay, and here is the counter of paying electricity bill. So this is the first person who is going to pay the bill and then move out. Then there is the next person who is going to pay the bill and then move out. And if some more persons are going to join, then all will going to stand at the last. Right? So from this point, we got to know that insertion always takes place from the back end and deletion always takes place from the front. Right? Insertion always takes place from the back end. Insertion always takes place from the back end and deletion always takes place from the front side. Right? So that is why it is known as first in, first out. The person which is going to be entered first is going to be move out first. So yeah, operation can be performed from the front as well as the back. I have shown you right now. Insertion takes place at the rear and deletion takes place from the front. This is known as front and this is known as rear. Always or not always, deletion take place from the front side and insertion take place from the rear side. Just like in a camera, we have front camera and rear camera. Okay. Then let's just take an example. Here are three elements, 1, 2, and 3, and we have tail and head. The first element is known as tail and the second, the first element of a queue is known as head. And the last element of a queue is known as tail. Okay? Front is known as head and rear is known as tail. We called it as tail. So let's say my first element is going to enter here. And currently my tail is on 3 and my head is also on 3. Why? Because this is the first element in my queue. Now the second one. So what happens? Tail will move to the second element and head will keep on staying here only. Then the third one, so tail will move to this portion, the last one, and head will remain here only. So this is how first element is known as head and the second element is known as tail. Then when it comes to deleting, so when I'm going to delete the first element, the first 3 will be deleted, so head will be pointed to the next one, the next pointer. In the same way, when 2 will be deleted, so head will be going to point at the first element. Okay, then, So when this person will be removed, the head will point to this person. when this person will be removed, the head will point this person, or if let's say one more person is going to join, the tail will point out the last person in the queue. Moving ahead, we have trees. Trees are helpful to define a hierarchy. Whenever you want to make a relationship, you want to store data in the form of hierarchy, so you use trees. It is having the first root, which is known as the root node, and further it goes down and down and down, just like the branches of a tree. The last node of the tree is called child node or the leaf node. Here is my root node first of all, then two child B and C, and then it is having two more children. So this is how you can say this is known as the root node, and all these four are known as the child nodes or the leaves. Then we have the last one here available, which is known as linked list. Linked list is a list which contains two types of data, two data basically. One is data field and next is the next field. But before understanding, okay, fine. Moving ahead then. Data field holds the data and the next points the next node. Data, what does it contain? It contains the actual data, and the field, next field, contains the address of the next node basically. And the first node is called the head. Like this way, here this is the first node, this is the second node, and this is the third node. Now the first question arises is why we use linked list, right? So I have a reply to this. Let's say this is my memory. Okay, in my memory I have blocks because data is stored in the form of blocks. And let's say this is the address 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And here some data is stored. Let's say here, hello. Here, how? Say here is 5. Okay, so some data is stored in my memory. It means my memory is having some data. Now let's say I am going to create an array of size C. Let's say I want to make an array of size 3. The problem with array always creates continuous space. Continuous space means it needs to be continuous, but here there is nothing, no space where three spaces are free. Either here one, only one is here only two is here, and here only one. So it will not create array. We cannot create an array because there are no continuous spaces, contiguous spaces. But if we talk about list, and I'm going to make a linked list of size 3, what happens? It takes non-contiguous spaces also. So what it actually has done? One second. So what it actually has done? It has taken this space as it finds that yes, this space is empty, and this is empty, and this is empty. So my size, linked list size is occupied, three sizes are there, and the spaces or the memory is not in contiguous form. So we should know the address of the memory where all my data is stored. It is very obvious. Memory is a very big size, and how to check out where my data is stored? So that is why linked list contains the address of the next node. So let's say here my A is stored, and in this A, it will store the data or the address of this node. Okay. Now I'm going to give some names here. Let's say 101 is this. This is 202. This is 81. Let's say, and this is at first position. It's an example. Okay. So at this particular field, we have first node, and in that node, we have data A. And in the next, we will store or the computer will store 202. So that I can move to the next node, I can access the next data. In the same way, here is the data, and here what it will store? It will store the address of the next node, which is 81. Then again, moving down, it will store the data of next node, which is 1. And at last, we have nothing. No node is there, so it will store null. It means the end of linked list. After that, we have no other value or no other data. So this type of linked list is known as singly linked list. What does it known as? It's known as singly linked list, which contains two fields, data and the next pointer. Next pointer, what does it do? It contains the address of the next node where the data is stored. Now we have one more list available. That is known as doubly linked list. In doubly linked list, we have one more field. Let's say this is my node. It contains the data, middle one is the data one. This is the next. And this is the previous. Okay? It contains three fields. Previous, data and the next. So here is an example. This is my head, the first node, and this is my last node. So as this is my first node, in the previous we will put null because there is no node before this node. So null will be there. And let's say the address of this is 1, this is 7, this is 20 and this is 45. Okay. So here some data is stored. Let's say A, B, C and D. Now this node will contain the address of this one, that is 7. This B contains the address, B next contains 20, like we did in singly linked list, and this contains 45. Right. Now coming to the backend portion, this contains the address of the previous node. And what is the previous node? The previous node is this. And what is the address? That is 1. So here we will write 1. In the same way, the next address here we will store is 7. And then here we will store 20. And at last, we have null pointer at the backend. What is the advantage of doubly linked list? It means we can access the data from the reverse as well as from the front side also. It is working from both the sides. But in this singly linked list, we can access data from one side, means from left to right side only. But here we can access data in reverse order also. So this is it for the day. I hope you liked the video and we have discussed all the things in briefing. In the next video, I'm going to share you how you can make the program and what are the things. One more thing is left, actually. Operations on data structures. What are the operations we will do in data structures? First is insertion, deletion, searching of files, data, traversing. Traversing means accessing all the data. Then sorting, and then last is merging. These are the six operations we are going to do in data structure. So this is it for the day. Thank you very much. Goodbye.